views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hello and welcome to the BronxNet studios located right here on the beautiful campus of Lehman College. Each week, our team of creative students and passionate professionals shine a light on the people, stories, and events through our community. I'm Mandy Reyes and I would like to welcome you to this edition on the Weekend Review. Hello and welcome to the Weekend Review. Senator Jeff Klein held a panel discussion at the College of Mount Sinai Vincent on the IDC plan to make education attainable for all. Reporter Taylor Carter has the story.
As college tuition rises every year across the state of New York, finding a way to pay for college has put a huge financial strain on many families. Senator Jeff Klein held a panel discussion named Cutting College Costs. The IDC plan to make higher education attainable by all at the College of Mount St. Vincent in the Bronx. In conjunction with other local colleges, the unveiling of this 7-point solution proposal was a focus on the current and future college students to lessen the economic burden.
Well, this is extremely important to me, and I think we have to make sure that college is truly affordable for all. And that's why we laid out a 7-point plan to deal with college affordability. First of all, we have to expand TAP. And when we expand TAP, it means expanding TAP for all. Regardless of immigration status, that's something that's extremely important. And I think we have to send a very clear message that we have to help all students. Not only students who attend SUNY and CUNY, we have to help them, but we have to help students who choose to go to a private institution as well.
The audience included college presidents and faculty members from neighboring local colleges in the Bronx. The president of Mount St. Vincent, Dr. Charles L. Flynn Jr., weighs in on his stance on Senator Klein's proposal and how it will be beneficial for private as well as SUNY and CUNY school students, specifically with increasing New York State TAP.
It's really beneficial. The effect of the senator's proposals, including the increase in TAP, is to reduce student debt. These proposals do not increase revenue to any college. They reduce the amount that students and their families would have to borrow. That's a very good thing. It's a good first step. Do students have to, when the average debt from SUNY and CUNY and as well as independents is over $30,000, is reducing the amount of money that students need to borrow to go to college a good thing? Absolutely.
Attending college greatly impacts the families of students, but the student perspective of this proposal is crucial because they are the ones being directly affected. The future incoming student success relies heavily on the financial standpoint, as paying for college can impact the students in their decision to attend the college of their choice.
Students deserve a choice. Schools are not a one-size-fits-all kind of option. So today, I'm here to thank Senator Klein for this common sense plan, and I'm also here to call on my legislators to support a plan like this that would increase TAP and allow my peers to have an affordable education at any school they'd want.
This panel, held by Senator Klein, is a major step forward in supporting current and future college students' dreams to attend and succeed in college. If colleges choose to adopt the 7-point solution here in New York State, who knows what other states may follow and fulfill more dreams of our future leaders of the United States of America. This is Taylor Carter reporting for BronxNet.
The Hindu Festival of Color is an opportunity to give thanks, appreciating what you have, and coming together as a family. Reporter Natalia Quiñones tells us more.
Drums, dancing, and colors. The Festival of Colors, also known as the Holi Festival, is a celebration of giving thanks, appreciating what you have, as well as coming together as one family. This celebration was brought together as a way to conglomerate the new year and preserving the true meaning of power unity.
It's beautiful to be in the mandir today and celebrate the different colors. Is the good over evil, and we are happy. It's cold outside, so we celebrate in the mandir.
Celebrating the Festival of Colors not only unites the Hindu community, but also allows any person who wishes to form part of this unique and lively activity. Faces and clothing get painted on with vibrant colors to represent good over evil. The vibrant color also symbolizes spring approaching, good emotions, and happiness.
Today we're celebrating the festival of Holi. It's an amazing day, the coming of spring, good over evil, new beginnings, and it's just so joyful to have the entire community out and about and just playing with different colors. The different color represents life, new beginnings, new relationships, and it's a great time for the diverse community to come out, not only Hindus, but we see other people coming out and partaking in the festival.
This particular festivity, apart from allowing anyone to take part of, also encourages everyone, no matter what age, from the youngest to the eldest person in the room, to get up and dance to the rhythm of the drums.
I'm happy that I get to play with my cousins, friends, and family, but I'm cold. I'm sad because we can't do it outside because it's cold.
We play Tasa today for Vishnu Mandir, and it's always an honor to play Tasa for Pagwa. Pagwa is one of my favorite holidays. It always makes me remember when I was a kid, my family, playing with the colors, having fun with my cousins, my friends. It's just a great family holiday for everyone to enjoy.
This brings out a lot of excitement because it is a tradition. It's within us. This is what dates back a long time ago. This was going on long before we were even born. And this is part of our religion. This is our culture. This is our belief. And this goes on every year. And to us, it's an everyday thing. Because it's not like, oh, that we would have to prepare for it every year. We do it every day. And we got so used to it, like it's fun for us now.
As we enter the spring season, the Hindu community celebrate the Holi Festival to bring unity and happiness among all. This is Natalia Quiñones reporting from BronxNet.
Ruben Diaz Jr. hosted his annual Irish American Heritage celebration to recognize the contribution the Irish immigrants and their descendants have played in the formation of the American society. Katia Lloyd Knight has a story.
And we're celebrating Greek Heritage Month. This is the month where the Greeks declared their independence 188 years ago from the Ottoman Empire. It is a perfect opportunity for us to come together and celebrate what Greeks and the Greek nationality has meant to the entire world, to the United States. When you look at architecture, when you look at the basic forms of our government, when you look at literature, Greek mythology, these are all the things that the Greeks have contributed.
Not to mention the Greek cuisine that is out in plenty at this Greek heritage celebration. Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz Jr. continues to tell us why it was important for him to take a break to celebrate the Greek Americans.
We've all come together to take a pause and say thank you for your contributions to the Bronx. Thank you for all of your contributions to Queens, to all of the boroughs, to the city of New York, and making us a better place. And as the borough president, I'm just here to say thank you. I'm proud of you. Keep up the good work. And we're here to recognize four of them.
And those four are elated to be recognized for their contribution to the Greek community.
I'm a Greek American. I'm very proud to be a Greek American. I work in city government, and I've been in government for almost 20 years. And it's a great honor to, be recognized for our contributions to the city and everything.
My goal is to help the whole city and to work with every community in this city, not just the Greeks, which are a very small portion, but everybody who's in this city, and to make it a safer place, even safer than it is now.
I'm getting honored as one of the people. I have the Royal Coach Steiner in the Bronx.
Marika, who is the former president of the parish council at the Church of St. Peter the Apostle, was very happy to be honored as she has been the president for 6 years and now retiring. She didn't fail to talk to us about her church and the Greek community.
Greek people around here, if somebody don't know, he can come. I have a service, I have for Easter, Sundays I have a service. So, and every day finish, come down, enjoy a coffee, everything. It's nice here.
The celebration continued. showcasing the Greek Children's Choir and the community members. For BronxNet, I am Katie Loy Knight.
From your first sunrise to the sunset of life, we are with you through life's journey. Social Security, securing today and tomorrow. Visit socialsecurity.gov.
This video produced at U.S. taxpayer expense.
Welcome back to the Weekend Review. March is all about music and the Pregones Theater, where the Blomblenazo Collective shared a combination of La Bomba and La Plena musicians from New York and Puerto Rico to shine a light on the Afro-Boricua Criollo genre. Let's take a look.
March is music right at the Pregones Theater. On stage is Bomblenazo Collective. This band is a combination of La Bomba and La Plena musicians from New York and Puerto Rico, with the common purpose of sharing Afro-Boricua Criollo musical genres.
This is really hard work, how tradition is nourished, because other artists care. As you can see, there are traditional practitioners of this form, La Plena y La Bomba, very folkloric.
I got the pleasure of being in the audience to watch the concert. With the beating of the drums, hearing the trombone and other instruments along with singing and dancing, it was just enjoyable. Also caught up with one of the younger members of the audience, and overall, she loved it.
It gives me a lot of pride and a lot of excitement of my own culture of being a Puerto Rican.
Pregones Theater gave us a taste of Puerto Rico's music and dance from the best band in this type of genre. For BronxNet, I am Kate Aloy Knight.
Bronx residents and NYC Pipes and Drums celebrates the St. Patrick's Day Parade in the Throgs Neck section of the Bronx. Reporter Arlene Mukoko tells us more.
Irish eyes were smiling for the 19th annual St. Patrick's Day Parade along East Tremont. The day was also about celebrating the Bronx's Irish-American community here in the Throgs Neck section. John Twomey of the New York City Transit Pipes and Drums has lived here for 61 and a half years.
We're going to lead off the parade and we'll be done quick instead of waiting out here freezing.
But warm hearts prevailed in the group that began their tradition of performing beginning in 1999.
Well, we just enjoy the pipes, enjoy our neighbors, and we want to play for them.
It's an incredible honor for the fact that both my parents were from Ireland.
Also there from the start, proud Bronxite and Irish American from the Norwood Woodlawn section, Derek Woods, who covers the parade for BronxNet Television and now this year is the Grand Marshal.
I was so honored to be able to cover the Bronx for so long, and then for the Throgs Neck Benevolent Association to thank me in this way, to ask me to be Grand Marshal this magnificent parade. It's just an incredible, incredible feeling.
Honorees riding this carriage were sisters Peggy Gannon, Joan Marie Leary, and Betty McLaughlin, and the organizers of the event, the Throgs Neck Benevolent Association.
This is a great day for Throgs Neck. It's a great day for the Bronx, and we're pleased to have all these bands and groups here in the cold.
Sure, it's been fantastic. The community loves it.
Starting with just an idea and the will to see an event like this, the parade is one that continues to grow.
Everybody every year comes to this parade. This is a big deal in this neighborhood. Today, everybody is Irish.
I'm Irish Boston, so I feel like I'm a little bit at home today.
It is so important that we come out and we march today with the Irish community to celebrate all the contributions that the Irish have made, not only to New York, but to our country.
It might be cold outside, but this parade is warming the hearts of many here on East Tremont. For BronxNet, this is Arlene Mukoko.
The Bronx Museum presented a new exhibition, Love Thy Neighbor. Let's take a look.
The Bronx Museum highlighted immigration awareness through art and live performances. Many New Yorkers came out to watch and experience Latin American artists showcase their new work in the Love Thy Neighbor exhibition. The Love Thy Neighbor creator, Sofia Hernandez, tells us why she selected three different Latin American artists Furthermore, Hernandez explains how the Love Thy Neighbor exhibition explicitly focuses on immigration political matters.
The entire exhibition series of The Neighbors deals directly with questions of identity politics, and immigration has been a very large subject. So the exhibition title, Love Thy Neighbors, is one that is drawn both from the gospel, as it is also drawn from the political demonstrations that have been taking place as of late. So here, the idea of the neighbor, or stranger, or foreigner relates to anyone that is outside of our immediate circle, and that the invitation is to be able to address them.
Although the artists in the Love Thy Neighbor exhibition were inspired by current immigration happenings, Dominican-American artist Federley Baez explains to us how women who immigrate can be tremendously inspiring for art.
It's both immigration, how borders are fluid, people are constantly traveling between both, but also women's rights and what it takes to be able to live a life on your terms despite all the forces that are outside of you. These were women who existed in extreme patriarchy, both in the Caribbean and in the U.S., but they navigated in ways that were true to themselves.
Ignacio Gonzalez presents his latest work titled Antisocial. The artwork consists of images printed on ceramic plates positioned to wrap around the art gallery. It resembles hundreds of police drawings that have targeted a specific group.
For the last decade, I've been archiving all these little drawings. And what I do, it's like go to social media, like Instagram, New York City, and look at the drawings and try to match them to people that resemble them.
Art is a way to express personal emotions one may experience, but the Latin American artists featured in the Love Thy Neighbor exhibition have taken art to another level by creating a gallery that showcases a current political focus like immigration. For BronxNet, Mandy Reyes.
Two up-and-coming artists in the Bronx filmed a music video for their new song together at the Miami Sports Bar in the Bronx. Reporter Aaliyah Hernan tells us more.
Two upcoming artists performed their music video for new single together at the Miami Sports Lounge in the Bronx, promoting unity throughout the city. Both artists express how important it is for them in a time where it is most needed for us as a people to set aside our differences and support one another.
Well, the purpose of this music video is to get people to come closer, to get united, to just be together. You know, it's a rough time that we're going through right now. And I think we've gotten so far throughout time, and now it just feels like we're almost backsliding.
Basically, EC and myself put a record together with everything that's kind of going on, you know, since we obviously changed presidency and things of that nature. We kind of both agree that, I don't know if everyone feels the same way, but it feels like there's a little bit of a division overall amongst the people. Racially, religion-wise, and I feel that it's kind of created somewhat of a state of separation. So the title of the track, it's called Together. And so with the message that we're trying to convey with this particular record is that, you know, in the grand scheme of things, whatever walk of life you are actually from, unity, togetherness, peace, these are all elements that are needed in order for us to all grow.
Ironically, the song was released January 19th, the same day Donald Trump took office. The two artists recently performed the single in Times Square for the I Am Too Muslim protest, hosted by Russell Simmons. The individuals behind the project believe that the message has and will get across rapidly, being that most Americans have the same ideals.
Well, I want him to accomplish the meaning to touch many people. Music industry is very, you know, high populated. Many people want to sing a song and they want to touch people. But it's the meaning that comes about, you know. It's really what you want to say to people. And this is the best song I thought would be the right one to do.
In these times of discrimination, the people of the Bronx need a voice to express their emotions. And the artists here are doing just that. This is Aaliyah Herndon for BronxNet.
Morning, Gary. We are GetSchooled.com. You want a college education, don't you? Gary, financial aid forms.
Biology homework, G. What?
Picking a college, man. You and us go together like tacos and Tuesday.
And I love tacos.
Hello and welcome back to the Weekend Review. If you missed any part of this week's show, be sure to check out all of these stories on BronxNet.org, Files Channel 33 or Optimum Channel 67. And don't forget to keep up with us through Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. The Pagua Holi celebration expressed the coming of spring through celebration of colors as well as Hindu culture and music. Reporter Shanice Powell has a story.
The Hindu Fagwa Holi Festival celebrates the coming of spring and the idea of love and all that is good. Vibrant music, colorful dusts, dancing, and great energy painted the space of Castle Hill Little League, so the Bronx could enjoy the myriad of colors in anticipation of the coming season.
Pagua is a festival of colors, and it's a diversity of all religion, race, color, creed, and the people.
All different cultural people are here today, Hispanic, Black, Puerto Rican, Irish. It's great to have them share our special day with us today.
The energy of Fagua not only causes different cultures to merge, but encourages a kind-hearted move from different parts of New York, including the NYPD.
Well, NYPD, there's a lot of community events, and since I live in the district and I like having the people of the Bronx know of our Hindu religion and exposing it to our community, and like they said, we live in a diversity community, which I love very much, and there's going to be more and more Hindu events that we're looking to bring back to the Bronx and expose it to all different cultural people.
It's very great to have everyone from Queens as well as the Bronx, Brooklyn, Long Island came out and support us. When they heard that we are putting on the 2017 Bronx Pagua Mela, they all reach out to us and support us with open arms.
Though they experienced setbacks in the past, the Lotus Flames and J&S Food Pantry powered through to make this event happen and give back to the community.
Although we are not in business with Lotus Flames since January because of a fire in the building, we still wanted to continue giving back to the community.
Last December 2016, we donated 400 toys to the children in the shelter and the unfortunate kids that wouldn't have a home.
Considered one of the oldest traditions of the Hindu culture, the Fagwa Holi Festival continues to spread its infectious energy here in the Bronx through colors and music. From BronxNet, this is Shanice Powell.
After recent incidents, Hostels Community College holds session in which they can inform and help students and parents with concerns about immigration laws. Reporter Katie Lloyd Knight tells us more.
Fear has gripped America's immigrant community because of the recent reports that federal agents have become newly aggressive under President Trump, who vowed to create a deportation force, said the Washington Post. And that is the topic of the Center for Nonprofits public conversation at Hostos Community College, because that immigration report is now the concern of many New Yorkers.
I'm a social worker at the college, and we deal with a lot of immigrant challenges and a lot of the concerns that our students are experiencing. So the work that we do is really trying to give them the factual information, try to ease some of the anxieties that they might be experiencing, and also connect them to great resources in the community that specifically work with the immigrant population. Some of the concerns are, if they are undocumented, are they going to be pulled off the street and sent back to a country that they may not have ever been to? Or, you know, some of our students are DACA students, the Dreamers, and they've come here at such a young age. And the concern is, will they then get targeted and taken out of this country and put somewhere which they may not have such a strong connection to? You know, students are in college to move forward, to develop a career, and a lot of the media and information that they're getting is can be scary and cause a lot of anxiety.
And that's just concerns of the students. But the parents are also afraid of sending their children out to school in fear of them or themselves getting deported. Eileen Newman told us what she had seen in the past couple weeks.
There's a Head Start program, and we're finding that people don't want to bring their kids. They don't want to sign up and give information because they're frightened. They're frightened that the kids could be taken, they could be taken, any information is going to be used against them.
Eileen Newman went on to say that this public conversation is about finding ways to find solace with each other and to find solace with other people who need it.
We've been conducting a lot of Know Your Rights forums, both in English and Spanish, throughout the community, in religious centers, in community centers, in schools, doing our best to educate parents about what they can do and community members about what they can do if they have interactions with ICE or with the police. There's a lot of misinformation out there. We're trying to give people information about how they can connect with lawyers who are free and who are, we're hopefully not going to take advantage of this scary situation.
Because of this public conversation, Bronxites were able to get information about their rights and where to go for help. For more information, visit the website www.bronximmigrationpartnership.org. For BronxNet, I am Kate Aloy Knight.
The annual Abrazo Garifuna event was held at Maestro's Catering Hall, truly uniting the small culture on a special night full of food, dance, and happiness. Reporter Eileen Makoko has the story.
State Senator Ruben Diaz Sr. hosts Abrazo events throughout the year to celebrate the borough's diversity. And here at Maestro's Catering Hall, it's Abrazo Garifuna. He was joined by colleagues in government, including Bronx County Democratic Chair Marcos Crespo, New York City Councilman Rafael Salamanca, and New York State Assemblyman Michael Blake of the 79th District, also a recent winner of one of the vice chair positions in the Democratic National Committee.
This is one of the five abrazo. We do abrazo Boricua for the Puerto Rican, abrazo Afro-American for the Afro-American people. We do abrazo Dominica for the Dominican. We do Abrazo Bangladesh, and this is Abrazo Garifuna for the Garifuna community.
Each presented an honoree making a difference in the community, which began migrating primarily from Honduras in the 1930s, today numbering at approximately 225,000 in New York City with about 100,000 here in the Bronx. It was not until the Happyland Social Club fire in March of 1990 that claimed the lives of 87 people, with the majority Garifunas, that leaders worked to publicize their history.
And it's to commemorate the 320th anniversary of the forcible deportation of the Garifuna people from the island of St. Vincent and their settlement in what is now known as Honduras. This event is significant because Garifuna American Heritage Month in New York is the only celebration of the Garifuna heritage. Even though we have been here since the 30s, New York City didn't find out that we were here until March 25, 1990, the Happyland Social Club fire.
Also a leader in the Garifuna community today, Suma Arzu Brown with the New York City Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, is also author of Bad Hair Does Not Exist, to empower young women and girls. She addressed the annual tradition sponsored by Senator Diaz Sr.
He refused to identify us as being a part of the most horrific fire that the Bronx had ever had, but he identifies us as one of the richest cultures the Bronx has. So as a Garifuna woman myself, I am so proud and so privileged to just participate.
Part of the rich history is expressed in dance featured here. Felix Gamboa is founder and executive director of the Chief Joseph Chatouillère Dance Company, named after the one-time leader of the Garifunas.
The name Chief Joseph Chatouillère, this was that brave Garifuna man who fought fiercely in defense of our territories in St. Vincent and the Grenadines when the Europeans and the French came over the land.
This is about preserving dance and culture that dates back to the 16th and 1700s, brought to life right here, right now, in 2017. For BronxNet, this is our report.
Unfortunately, that's all the time that we have for today. If you missed any of our stories, make sure to tune in to Open on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays at 10 a.m., as well as visit us at bronxnet.org and stay connected through us through social media. This is Mandy Reyes reminding you to stay tuned to our channels here on BronxNet. We'll be right back.